Hi, my name is Miguel Arteta. I'm the director of Beatriz at Dinner, and I'm saying hello at an entertainment affair.
So, Beatriz at Dinner is coming up on DVD, and we're very excited because this movie just gave a lot to talk about. This is the first time that we see Salma Hayek as maybe her best character.
Thank you very much.
I have never seen Salma so true, you know, so honest, so rare, so rare.
I'm so proud of her. She like dug really deeply. She's very funny. She's very beautiful. And we've seen her do glamorous roles and very funny roles. But this is a movie where she's naked emotionally. Right. Like she's like showing her heart in a way that I am so proud of her. I've never seen her do something like this. And she blew my expectations. I wanted her to be great, but she came. You know, she has an enormous heart, and she just was so present that just put it on the line. So if you're a Salma Hayek fan, definitely see Beatriz at Dinner.
Yeah, she's amazing. And the storyline as well. I mean, the whole movie as a whole, it's beautiful. I mean, it has a lot of layers, and I wanted to talk about that. So when you get the script, you wrote the script for Salma Hayek, right?
Mike White, the writer, wrote it for her. He came up with the idea, and before he wrote it, he said, let's go meet with her, see what she thinks of this. And she heard the idea of it and said, I want to do it. And then Mike went and wrote it.
Wow.
But she's a fan of his work, and she's been a fan of mine. She hired me for Ugly Betty, and we've been wanting to work together for a long time. But, you know, she just loved the idea of the movie, of playing an immigrant who plays, you know, she's like a healer, and she believes in compassion to such a degree that she almost doesn't have a place in the world to live in. And she gets trapped at this dinner party. We can all relate to a dinner party. We've all been at dinner parties where we've been stuck with people we don't want to be stuck with. And she gets stuck with somebody who's almost like a Donald Trump character. And played by John Lithgow, and so it was really fun. And what I'm most proud about is that Beatriz at Dinner is the kind of movie that I would want to go see. I like movies that have a message, but they are not serious. Like they have a sense of humor. They're entertaining. They have weird humor to it, so that it's not just also serious. And I think we have achieved that with this. This is it's a fun ride. It's an anxious ride. It's a funny ride, but hopefully it will also make you think a little bit.
It's funny that you say that the character, it's similar to Donald Trump in all sense. Was it done on purpose?
I mean, a little bit. Like Mike, I think came up with the idea when that dentist had killed Cecil the lion in Africa, and Mike was really really outraged. We all felt terrible, and also when Donald decided to run and said those awful things about Mexicans, and so Mike. I think the idea for him was like, what would if I was with somebody like this at a dinner party, stuck with them, what would I do? Would I take a butter knife and stick it in his neck? What would I do? And from that came the idea for Beatriz at Dinner.
Right. Yeah. When you have so much bad going on or such bad people, do you just kill it? If you kill it, you're done with the problem, right? Well, sometimes you do feel like that.
I know. It's like
that's crazy.
It's so frustrating that like. You know, we feel like we don't have power to affect the people that have power over us.
Yes.
And sometimes we want to just lash out at them. I think what's most wrong in the world is when people in this positions of power are abusing people who don't have power, who are less lucky than them. And we deal with that in our everyday life all the time. You see it, those dynamics. There are people who are in power who don't hesitate to abuse their power, and I find it just so horrible, and it's the tragedy in life, and we wanted to say something about that.
Yeah, they call it the film done in eras, in Donald Trump's era. The film was created in Donald Trump's era.
Well, we premiered the movie at the Sundance Film Festival 2 days after the inauguration, so people were a little confused that there was a movie that represented kind of this Trumpian area so quickly. When we filmed it, we never thought he would be president. It was just really to make a movie about how divided the world is. And then, you know, it was a small consolation that our movie became more relevant, that he got elected. But it's crazy how him being elected has made the world, an already divided world, so much more divided.
Yes.
And so in some ways, Beatriz at Dinner has resonated with people because we are thinking about that a lot more, you know?
Yeah. How do you feel about
Donald Trump's
decisions right now and
everything
that's going on as a Puerto Rican?
As a Puerto Rican, I feel like Donald Trump is a liar and a con artist and a hypocrite, and I definitely think he's racist. And but I think the thing that is most interesting is that he's done a con job in America. I think the people that elected him don't quite realize that he's lied to them. This is the biggest con job in history.
Right.
And I think they're soon going to realize that they've been lied to. And you know, it's not going to go so well for Donald Trump.
Do you think he's going to be reelected after this, the four years are over?
I think there's no chance.
Okay.
You know, first of all,
I mean, I thought there was no chance of him winning, but...
No, but I think young people, I mean, there was a perfect storm of problems. But you have to realize Donald Trump only got elected by 67,000 votes.
Right.
In three states. If people in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, 67,000 of them had voted differently, Hillary would have won. It's that close.
Yeah.
And so he barely got in there. Even though in electoral votes, it looks like he has more votes. But the truth of the matter is that it's because three states went the other way and they were that close, those states. So I don't think there's any chance. You know, America is becoming more racially diverse every year.
Right.
And now that he's been the best advertisement for people to wake up and vote and not let someone like him get elected ever again. So
in Puerto Rico, do you guys have the same opportunities as you have here in California?
Yeah. I mean, like Puerto Ricans are American citizens, so we have like a real advantage to a lot of Latino immigrants. But the economy there is very bad, and so things are difficult in Puerto Rico. But we do have the ability to, we don't have to fight for a green card, or you have an American passport. You're not allowed to vote for president if you're living in the island. So
you're not allowed.
Not allowed. So that's
doesn't make sense, right? It should change soon.
I hope that would change. Yeah, but I think any person of color in the United States feels not totally welcome, and that is something that had been, in some ways improving. But as we devalued education, our consumer society has made it so that politicians, pay less importance to education, because uneducated population is easier to manipulate into buying and becoming a consumer society. We've been doing that for 40 years, since the 60s, and I think that the result is like this: people become less and less educated, more and more ignorant, and hence more racist. And so, it's been good for capitalism, and then now here we are. You have a population that is so uneducated that they can be conned by somebody as awful as Donald Trump.
Hopefully we can survive this 4 years.
Oh, my God. Hopefully he'll be gone before then.
I mean, let's cross fingers.
Yes.
So tell me a little bit about your career, how it developed. So you were born in Puerto Rico, and then who gave you your first opportunity, or how did you get, how did you know it started?
I have to thank my parents. They gave me an education. They worked really hard. They were so, they didn't know what to say when I said I was going to be a filmmaker. They were like, that's like being a poet. How are you going to make money? And but they worked hard, and they still believed in me after that. So I'm very lucky. But my first break came because my car mechanic watched a short film. I gave him a short film I made, and he introduced me to Jonathan Demme, who did Silence of the Lambs. He's a great director. And Jonathan mentored me, and so I was very lucky. So
you had really good mentors.
The moral of the story is be nice to your car mechanic, because you never know when they're going to give you a break.
So that's how you started.
That's how I got started.
Would you say it was an easy ride, or there was some
thumbs up? I've been very lucky. My parents gave me an education. I was able to go to college and to the American Film Institute, And so I had so many privileges and opportunities. But it's very hard. The industry is hard. You know, like my first film, I lived in my basement, and, you know, we lived on credit cards. It took 4 years. We had 13 credit cards maxed out. And then we got lucky enough to go to the Sundance Film Festival and sell it and got and started my career where I started to get paid, finally.
Okay. So you have to invest a lot first. And, you know, sacrifice.
Yeah, persistence. Yeah, you have to be really persistent and never take a rejection personally.
So what do you think is your biggest achievement of all?
Well, I definitely think Beatriz at Dinner is like the culmination of my career because, as I said, I wanted to make a movie that that was fun, that entertained you, but also made you think. Those are the kind of movies that I want to go see. You know, like I'm most excited when a movie is like has a sense of humor, but it also is really thoughtful.
Yes.
And I feel like we kind of accomplished that pretty well with Beatriz at Dinner. So I would say that's the movie I'm most proud of.
And that's one of my favorite films of in a long time.
Beatriz at Dinner.
I watched it twice in the theater.
Thank you.
There's a part that she says, "You killed my goat."
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm. But that man didn't. Killed my goat.
Man killed my goat.
Yes. But in the movie, Salma's character, Beatriz, loves animals, and she keeps animals in her house. She keeps baby goats that she has rescued, and her neighbor has killed one of them because they make noise. And she's devastated by this. She's an animal lover. Mm-hmm. And then she gets stuck at this dinner with this Donald Trump-like character, and she starts to realize that it's people like him that are just abusing power that give permission to the kind of violence that would result in a neighbor saying, your goat's making a little noise, I'm just going to kill it. And I don't have any compassion for that living thing or for you. I think that she's sort of saying, it is this mentality where that you think you have entitled to abuse people that gives permission for people to be violent. And we're seeing it in this country. You know, our president is literally, basically, encouraging violence everywhere. And so I think that's what she means by that when she says at the end of the movie, that man killed my goat.
So your interpretation to the end, because it's intriguing.
We can't give it away.
We can't give it away, but you've got to watch it.
I hope you'll be surprised by it. But we wanted to, at the end, turn the movie, you know, around and make you have to really think about how you feel about the situation. And so the movie offers a couple of alternatives on how to deal with this awful mentality that is controlling the world now. You know, like, should you be violent or should you not be violent? Should we give up or is there no hope? And the movie kind of opens all those possibilities so that you will think about it.
What do you think? Should we give up or should we keep on going and
we need
be
to
hopeful?
Fight. We need to vote. Most importantly, like in 2018, you gotta go vote. Like, that's very important. We're very lucky that we can vote. So I think we have to do everything we can to get young people especially to go out. You know, young people don't want to vote because they're so used to, like, iPhones and the internet. Voting seems archaic, seems just like such a pain in the ass. I have to register, and then I have to wake up and go to some place. I can't just go on my phone like this. Well, that's the system. It's a very old system. So we have to teach our young people that even though it's a pain in the ass, you got to get your friends to register and to wake up and go and vote. Do it, because your life matters.
Is there anything else you want to add to this interview? ¿Algún proyecto que nos quieras dejar en las manos para Entertainment Affairs?
You know, I'm working on a movie with a Spanish actress named Laia Costa and an American actress named Alia Shaket that Mark and Jay Duplass produced. It's called Dark Butter. And you'll be seeing it next year. It's a very interesting movie about two women falling in love and spending 24 hours together without sleeping.
And, two women falling in love?
Oh, yes. And they spend 24 hours without sleeping just getting to know each other.
You like controversial movies, don't you?
I do. Huh. I do. I want to make movies that you will never forget.
Yes, like Beatriz at Dinner. So it's coming up. Do you know the date for the Blueberry DVD?
No, we are going... for Beatrice, the dinner is coming up in, I think, September 20th, I think it's out in DVD. It's available on iTunes right now. And so go rent it or go buy it pretty soon. I promise you, you will laugh.
Mm-hmm.
You will feel very anxious.
Yes.
And you,
and afterwards as well. Yeah.
And if you love Salma Hayek, I think you'll be very proud of her. I'm really proud of her.
She's amazing. She's awesome. There's a lot of Oscar buzz as well. Are you ready?
I hope so. I'm very proud of her. I hope she gets a nomination. And we need more Latinas out there getting recognized. So if you're an Academy member, go vote for Salma Hayek.
Do you think she believes it's her best role?
I think that and Frida. So yeah. You know, she spent 8 years making Frida. And I think that's an amazing performance. And so I think those are her two that I'm most proud of. I think she's very, very proud of both of them.
You think that you can hide up here behind these gates and that everything is going to be all right?
The world doesn't need your feelings. It needs jobs. It needs money. It needs what I do.
The world doesn't need you.
Doug is a great philanthropist.
Shut up, Gotha.
Hi, Chihuahua.
Okay, you're done.
Sorry. Thank you very much.
What were you thinking? My relationship with that guy paid for this house.
I kind of feel like I don't even know you. You don't know me.
Can't possibly end well.